Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Lord Kirkle's Money, Book 2 of Beyond the Western Sea by Avi, narrated by Simon Prebble.
Friday, January the 24th, 1851. Chapter 75. Farewell, England. A brisk, chill wind and a strong tide bore the Robert Peel down the Mersey River, away from the city of Liverpool, and out upon the rolling Irish Sea. On the main deck stood 350 emigrants, most of them Irish. They were of all ages, from children in mother's arms to the old and hobbled. Virtually everyone was dressed shabbily, though here and there, like plump plums in an otherwise poor pudding, could be seen those of a richer sort. Well off or poor, most were cold, many weak and ill. All were pondering what would happen to them next. But now that England had been left behind, and the ship's grey sails bulked large, even as her high, stout prow ploughed the waves, there was little the passengers could do but wait anxiously for some word from the ship's captain. Maura O'Connell, her brother Patrick, and their friend, Mr. Horatio Drabble, pressed side by side against the ship's bulwark, each lost in thought. Mr. Drabble, long, lanky, expanded his thin chest and breathed deeply of the rich sea air, hardly believing his good fortune. Just a few days ago, he had been trapped in the insufferable misery of Mrs. Sonderby's Liverpool basement. Now, he was sailing to America, the fulfillment of a dream long held. Watching England's coast fade in the distance, he felt the weight of past disappointments drop away. As far as he was concerned, he had already become a new man. His smile was as wide as his face. Maura O'Connell, brown hair blowing, red shawl aflutter, thought of her mother back in Ireland. While Maura could envision the woman wrapped in black saying her beads, the girl could not imagine where, in the ruins of Killarney Village, she might have found shelter. The thought brought tears to her eyes. And was not her brother, Patrick, too young, too headstrong? And did she not bear full responsibility for him? And then there was the actor, Horatio Drabble. Though he had been truly kind and helpful to them in Liverpool, Maura was not certain she knew him. There were times he seemed to be from quite another world, not because he was English, but because he, like Patrick, struck her as more boy than man. Then Maura thought, with some self-chiding, that soon they would be in America with their father, and she could turn over all her responsibilities to him. How well he'd care for them. Maura wanted little but some peace, some quiet, and some work to call her own. How fine that her father, rich man that he was, would provide it. The idea prompted one of Maura's rare smiles. Patrick O'Connell had no interest in observing either the passing scenery or the other passengers, nor was he pondering the future. He could think of nothing but Laurence, hidden below decks. So it was that he stared fixedly at Captain Rickles, splendid in grey uniform and red moustache, who was standing before the mainmast calling commands to the sailors in the high rigging. As Patrick watched, the first mate approached the captain, who introduced him to Mr. Drabble's friend, Mr. Grout, and his stout companion, whose name Patrick did not know. So great was Patrick's worry about Laurence that he simply assumed the subject of their discussion was stowaways. The notion filled him with dread. He must free Laurence. Satisfied that Maura was intent upon her own thoughts, Patrick murmured, "I'm going to watch from over there."
"Don't go far," Mr. Drabble cautioned. "They'll be letting us below soon."
Small and wiry, Patrick had little trouble slipping through the crowd to the opposite side of the ship. Once there, he climbed the ratlines a ways and held on, toes curling over the ropes. From this roost, he studied the main deck in search of some entry into the bottom hold. Only now did he admit to himself that he had no clear idea where or what the bottom hold was. In all his 12 years, he had never been on such a boat.
The words had made sense in Liverpool when Fred told him where he'd hidden Lawrence. They didn't make sense now. Looking about, Patrick noticed a sailor emerge from a closet-like structure almost directly below the main mast. Would that be a way? He asked himself. As soon as the sailor moved on, Patrick climbed down from the lines and stole a look inside the small structure. A narrow stairway led down. After checking to see if anyone was watching him, Patrick stepped into the alcove, made the sign of the cross, grasped the guide rope, and started to descend. The first level he reached was dim. Long rows of what appeared to be wide shelves stretched forward and aft into the darkness. As for cargo, he saw none. The steps continued down. He went on. At the next level, Patrick discovered a few candles set in wall-mounted glass bulbs. Their small yellow flames illuminated neat rows of boxes and crates. Here, surely, was the bottom hold. Taking up one of the candles, Patrick made his way toward the bow of the ship, only to come to a sudden heart-pounding stop. Before him gaped an open hatchway. One more step, and he would have plummeted down. From the open square of the hatch, a ladder dropped into the darkness, as black as his hair. Was there yet another, third hold below? Fred's words echoed in his mind.
The bottom hold!
Patrick stepped onto the ladder and began to climb slowly down. Candlelight revealed a dark cave-like expanse embraced by enormous arching timbers. Countless casks, barrels and chests, piled one atop the other, were deployed in rows that seemed to vanish fore and aft into murky blackness. The air was humid, clotted with the stench of rot and filth. Sounds of sloshing bilge water, the creaks and groans of the plunging ship, filled his ears. This, Patrick told himself with dread, must be the bottom hold. Leaving the ladder, Patrick moved warily in the direction he thought was forward, for Fred had also said, the bow. As Patrick crept along, the rough planking pricking his bare feet, he tried to examine each and every crate in fear of missing the one that bore the telltale X in a circle. Upon reaching the bow, Patrick held the candle up. A few feet from where he stood, he saw a coffin-like box wedged between two great beams as far forward as possible. On the side facing him, Patrick could just make out Fred's mark. Patrick ran to the box and tapped on it.
Lawrence, he called. Are you there, Lawrence?
When no answer came, he began to claw away at the boards. Chapter 76. In Search of Stowaways. On the quarterdeck, Mr. Murdoch, the first mate, assembled his stowaway search party. Two sailors, Mr. Grout and Mr. Clemspool. One sailor carried a long, sharp stick, the other a heavy hammer. Mr. Murdoch held a lantern.
All right, gents, the first mate began. You're welcome to come along to search for stowaways, if it's Captain Rickle's pleasure. I'm just warning you to keep behind me and the lads. If we find someone, they're liable to be desperate. You'll want us to deal with them, not yourselves.
No need to worry about me, sir, Mr. Clemspool replied heartily.
The further the ship drew away from England and Mr. Pickler, the more the man's cherub-like face resumed its cheerful demeanour.
My friend, however, who cannot claim more than 20 years of life, is quite another matter.
Indeed, Mr. Grout was finding the ship's motion most upsetting. His stomach was queasy, and his face had turned a pasty white. As the Robert Peel pitched and rolled, he was continually reaching out for support.
Will this here search take long?
He fretted.
I wouldn't think so, sir,
Mr. Murdoch told him, taking pleasure in the landlubber's uneasiness.
But you're welcome to step out any time and go to your stateroom. Just take yourselves a pull of fresh air before we go, because we start in the bottom hold, and it's not particular pleasant there.
Chapter 77. Lawrence Found. From inside the crate,
A weak and dazed Laurence blinked at the candle flame. His muscles were cramped, his stomach ached from hunger, his throat was parched.
"Is that you, Patrick?"
he beseeched hoarsely.
"Aye, it's me,"
Patrick replied, much relieved to have found his friend.
"And you, Laurence, are you all right?"
"I thought you'd never come,"
the English boy managed to say. "Didn't I tell you I would?" Patrick returned with pride, though as he spoke, he looked nervously back over his shoulder. Carefully, he helped Laurence from the crate, but the boy sank to the floor, too weak to stand.
"I'll be needing to put the boards back on," Patrick cautioned, "else for sure they'll know you've been in the box."
He set his candle aside and worked to shove the crate boards back into place.
"Now, Laurence," he said, kneeling before his friend, "you must listen to me, because I can't be staying long. I don't know where we're to be yet, so I can't take you with me. And faith, I'm thinking it wouldn't be safe for you there. Maybe you'd best bide some time here."
"Where?"
Laurence asked, too numb, too confused to think for himself.
"I'm not sure exactly," Patrick admitted. "You could try among the barrels over there. Only you'd best hurry, Laurence. They'll be searching for you."
"For me?"
whimpered Laurence.
"For any stowaways."
The miserable boy stared into the murky darkness.
"Laurence, you must look at me and listen. I'm going now, or my sister will be wondering where I am. You can hide yourself, can't you?"
"Patrick, will you come back soon?"
"Don't you be worrying about that,"
Patrick assured him as he retrieved the candle and backed away a few steps.
"You can be sure I'll come as often as I can."
"But..."
"Just hide yourself, Laurence,"
Patrick whispered with urgency as he moved further into the dark.
"Do you hear me? Hide yourself."
Laurence struggled to his feet.
"Patrick,"
he called. But the Irish boy had disappeared, though where, Laurence was not sure. Enveloped by inky blackness, Laurence stood where he was, sensing little more than the ceaseless pitching and yawing of the ship. The motion made him disoriented. It was hard to grasp what was happening.
"I'm going to America," he said out loud. "To America,"
he repeated, as though trying to convince himself. Then he added,
"I have no family. I have no money. My name is Laurence, and I..."
Suddenly he heard voices coming from above. Terrified of being caught, Laurence looked up and saw a beam of light cut down a ladder like a golden spike. Then he saw boots descending. Close to panic, he scrambled along the aisle in search of a hiding place. Chapter 78. Mr. Murdoch on the Prowl.
"Imagine people hiding in such a pestilential hole,"
Mr. Clemspool exclaimed.
"But they do,"
Mr. Murdoch said, as he swung his lantern beam about to illuminate the cargo. The smell in the hold was so nauseating that Mr. Grout pinched his nose.
"How can you find anyone here?"
he wondered as he gawked about.
"More a place for ghosts than living people."
Nervously, he reached out and rapped his knuckles upon wood, then grasped the same timber to keep himself steady.
"Aye, ships do have ghosts,"
Mr. Murdoch solemnly assured him.
"They do?" "It's a sailor's belief, sir, that ships are haunted by the souls of those who died trying to get on board, not to mention those who drowned during a voyage."
"Lord help us," Mr. Grout cried. "Are you speaking the truth?"
The first mate tipped a wink to Mr. Clemspool, who in turn encouraged the teasing with a grin.
"Course it's true," Mr. Murdoch insisted. "And you had best be on the lookout for him, sir."
In dread, Mr. Grouch shut his one good eye.
"Now, gentlemen," Mr. Murdoch said, "to business. Stowaways always think themselves clever by trying something different, except it's just those differences that help us find them. See these barrels here, gentlemen, stacked one atop the other, all neat and regular. Little likelihood of anyone being in them. Consider yourself."
He measured the large Mr. Grout with gleeful eyes.
"You could hardly get in one of them barrels now, could you, sir? And if you did," he added ominously. "We'd never pry you out alive. Regular bit of salt cod you'd be."
Mr. Grouch shuddered.
"Now, sir," the first mate continued, "what we do is look for what's irregular. Stowaways tuck themselves into corners, thinking they won't be noticed. We usually find them up forward, or aft by the bread and spirit ladders, where there's some open space. You'll see."
Holding his lantern before him, Mr. Murdoch led the way down the central aisle between the rows of cargo. Now and again, he nodded to one of his crew and pointed to a box or bale. The sailor either banged the box or poked a staff deep into it. But though they tried many times, no one was found. When they went as far forward as they could, the first mate gave a snort and pointed to an upright crate standing quite isolated in the bow. Its position had the look of irregularity, even to Mr. Clemspool's and Mr. Grout's unpracticed eyes. Grinning broadly, Mr. Murdoch beckoned to the sailors. They hastened forward and crouched at either side of the crate. The first mate gave a curt nod, reached out, took hold of one of the crate's slats and yanked. The board clattered to the floor. All five men leaned forward to see what was inside. It was empty.
"By God," Mr. Murdoch swore with rage. "Someone was here, and whoever he is, he's on board somewhere. Don't you fear, gents. I'll get him, and when I do, I'll make him jig to a lively tune."
Laurence, crouched deep among rows of barrels amidships, heard every word. To keep himself from sobbing, he bit hard into his lower lip. Chapter 79. A Proposal is Made. Mr. Drabble could not help himself. While Mora was caught up in her thoughts and worries, he had gazed at her intently, smiling broadly from time to time. Miss Mora O'Connell was the angel who had dropped through the miasma of Mrs. Sonderby's basement and led him out of loathsome Liverpool towards the promised land. Without her, the actor was convinced he would have perished. Indeed, it was far more than gratitude that he felt toward her. In a matter of days, he had fallen in love with her. The idea of loving Mora thrilled him. Was not he a gifted actor? Was not she a heroine? Was not her rescue of him the stuff of great drama? So he believed. Here they were, embarking on an epic voyage, the play. Here they were on a ship, the stage. There were the passengers, the audience. Here was his leading lady, Mora. Was not he, Horatio Drabble, destined to play the role of devoted lover? Was not loving this young woman the part he'd prepared himself for all his life? To each of these questions, Mr. Drabble answered a resounding yes. Now, as the ship sailed toward the Western Sea, the second act of the play, he felt compelled to speak the lines fate had written for him. "Miss O'Connell," he called gently. Mora, hearing her name, turned. Even as she did, Mr. Drabble gathered up one of her hands in both of his and embraced it with his long fingers. Solemnly, he pressed the hand to his lips, kissed it, then allowed himself a prodigious sigh. Mora was shocked. "My dear Miss O'Connell," Mr. Drabble began again, his face suffused with a pink glow that heightened the intensity of his brown eyes. "Though we've known each other but a short time, it has been long enough for me to discover your great virtues. The bard expressed it far, far better than I ever shall when he said, 'Love goes toward love.' May I, even as we set upon this voyage together, beg your permission to extend it through the rest of our lives?" Mora looked at him incredulously. Oblivious, Mr. Drabble smiled sweetly and went on. "What I am suggesting, my dear Miss O'Connell, in humbler words, is this. Will you bestow upon me the honour of your hand in marriage?" Mora's reaction shifted from shock to offence. How could this man, all but a stranger, speak to her, a girl alone, in such a way? but a stab of guilt quickly followed her sense of affront. What had she done to encourage this man? The answer was immediate and clear. She had allowed herself to become too familiar. In fright, she snatched her hand away and pressed it against her throat, as if to feel her words as she spoke them.
"Mr. Drabble," she stammered, "you must not say such things. You mustn't. If we're to be friends at all, and you've been a generous one, you cannot address me so. I am but 15 years of age. I'll not hear it."
Mr. Drabble sank to his knees. "Shakespeare's Juliet," he reminded her, "was a mere 14.
"By the Holy Mother, Mr. Drabble, I'm afraid I don't know this Juliet you're speaking of, and besides..."
Mora's words were interrupted by a voice that rang out across the deck. "Attention! Attention!" As one, the crowd of emigrants turned to see Captain Rickles addressing them through his speaking trumpet. "My first mate," the captain announced, "has informed me that there's a stowaway upon this ship. I warn you, do not aid this person. If you do, it will go as hard on you as on him when he's found, as surely he will be. But we are well off, and there will be no more green seaweed till we reach America. For now, all is in readiness for you to go below. Once there, you will be permitted to claim your berths. We expect orderly behaviour. There's room for all."
The captain's words galvanized the crowd. The emigrants snatched up their belongings and began to surge toward the steps that would take them below. Mora turned back to Mr. Drabble. The actor, still upon his knees, was gazing up at her as if he had not heard anything she or the captain had said.
"Please, Mr. Drabble, please," Mora begged in an agonized whisper. "You must get up. I'll not think of it again, nor, I beg, will you. Please."
Mora felt a pull on her arm. It was Patrick.
"And where have you been?"
she demanded, the harshness of her voice masking the great relief she felt that her brother was by her side again. Breathless from rushing up from below, Patrick could not speak. He could only shake his head.
"Are you ill?" Mora asked, instantly alarmed. "It's the rolling of the ship," he gasped.
A trembling Mr. Drabble pulled himself to his feet.
"Miss O'Connell," he managed to say in a voice barely above a whisper, "we had best go below ourselves."
Patrick looked from his sister to the actor. Though he had come too late to hear the exchange, he had seen the man on his knees and observed his sister's great agitation. Neither one would look at the other.
"He's asked her to marry him," Patrick thought with dismay, "and she's accepted."
Even if he had had the courage to inquire about it, which he did not, there was no time to do so. They gathered up their bundles and joined the crowd surging toward the entryway, the same that Patrick had used before. Slow as their descent was, the trio at last stepped upon the steerage deck where they were to live during the long weeks of the voyage. What they beheld made them gasp in astonishment. Chapter 80. The Steerage Deck. The few oil lanterns dangling from the low ceiling cast a dull, smoky light, making it impossible to see for any great distance. What was visible were two long rows of platforms, 45 to a side, set up like bunk beds, upper and lower. On the foot of each platform section, a number was chalked. These platform berths were built of soft and splintery wood and measured 6 feet by 6, boxed in by wood strips so as to keep occupants and their possessions from tumbling out. Wooden braces, none too strong, ran from floor to ceiling to hold the platforms up. As for the space between bottom and top, when one might hope to sit up, it was hardly more than a few feet. Patrick thought there must be 200 passengers already jammed into the narrow area between the facing rows of berths. Goods were being passed about, sorted, tearfully lost, searched for, loudly found, then lost again. Unwieldy mattresses were being unrolled. Trunks were opened and rummaged through, their contents spewing forth as from horns of shabby plenty, and further scattered by the constant rolling and pitching of the ship. And the noise. Babies were crying, children squabbling, adults shouting to make themselves heard above the din. The air was close, stinking with the crush of too many people in a space too small with too little ventilation. Mr. Drabble could barely breathe.
"Keep going along! Keep going!"
a sailor at the foot of the steps repeatedly cried.
"Take your berths! 4 persons to each! Keep moving! Keep moving! 4 persons to a berth!"
The newcomer struggled forward, loudly proclaiming this or that platform as the one assigned them, and crawling in, whether others were there or not.
"Where are we to go?"
Mora demanded of the sailor.
"What's your number?" he cried.
74.
"To the forward, lass," he shouted. "And you better be quick. Nothing lasts long here."
Mr. Drabble exclaimed. "Do you mean to say, sir, that these open platforms are our berths, where we are expected to live?"
"You can live or die on them, for all I care, mate,"
the sailor retorted.
"It's your place, so you can do what you likes. Now move yourselves, or you'll be trampled. There's 100 more behind you."
Propelled forward, Mora, Patrick and Mr. Drabble struggled through the crush of people. Each berth they passed was packed with occupants, pushing and jostling to establish themselves in some degree of comfort.
"Here's our number," Mr. Drabble announced finally. "Do you wish the top or lower berth?"
"Together?" asked a horrified Mora. Only minutes ago, this man had shocked her nearly to death with his proposal. Mr. Drabble glanced back. More passengers were pressing forward.
"It's either me or someone else, Miss O'Connell," he said.
Mora, furious at him, at herself, at everything, blushed to the roots of her hair.
"Mr. Drabble, it's not decent," she cried.
Then, embarrassed by her outburst, she turned away and stared back into the area towards the steps. Never in her wildest thoughts could she have imagined anything like this. She had considered Mrs. Sonderby's house ghastly. The steerage deck was 10 times worse. Chapter 81. Birthmates. Something crawled over Patrick's bare feet. Startled, he looked down just in time to see a brown rat scurry across the wooden floor and disappear beneath one of the lower platforms.
"Miss O'Connell," Mr. Drabble urged with a nervous glance at the flow of newcomers, "if we don't choose quickly, we'll be pushed aside."
Mora gave way.
"The top," she whispered. "Up you go,"
Mr. Drabble told Patrick. More than glad to leave the floor, the boy hauled himself to the higher berth. Once there, he looked down along the teeming deck, only to see Mr. Murdoch working his way through the crowd in their direction. Certain he was coming for him, Patrick, heart hammering, crammed himself into a far corner. As it was, the first mate pushed past, but Patrick was sure he looked right at him, as if to say,
"I know what you know."
It frightened him terribly.
"Patrick," Mora cried, "pay some mind."
She was handing up their few belongings. Then Mr. Drabble worked his way into the berth. He twisted about, but did not try to sit. There was no headroom.
"Can I help you up, Miss O'Connell?"
he said to Mora, his voice stiff with formality.
"No,"
she replied, full of mortification. As she stood there, another Irish family arrived, a man, his wife, and 2 young children.
"Would you be holding this spot?"
the man asked Mora, indicating the lower berth. Mora shook her head.
"In you go, then,"
the man instructed his family. All 4 hastily squeezed in, leaving their 2 trunks and 3 sacks to block the aisle. Another family appeared. It consisted of 2 boys, a girl, a large, fleshy-faced man with a mop of curly hair, and a woman who seemed to be in charge. The woman's long, tangled grey hair and ragged dress hid nothing of her squalidness. Though her appearance was one of frailty, her fixed and sullen eyes revealed a ferocity that promised argument.
"How many would you be having up there?" she demanded of Mora.
"The 3 of us," Mora felt obliged to reply.
"And wouldn't you know that each berth is meant for 4?
The woman cried shrilly as she pushed the small, dirty girl forward. The girl, no more than 8, Mora thought, bore such a marked resemblance to the woman
It was clear that she was her daughter. But it was fright, not fierceness, that Mora saw in her eyes.
"This will be yours, then, Bridie Ferity," the woman informed her bewildered child, indicating the top berth where Patrick and Mr. Drabble already were. "Get yourself in before someone steals that from us, too."
"But, madam," Mr. Drabble tried to object, "we're already three." To Mora's further embarrassment, he added, "And we are a family."
"Begar, you could be the Queen's horse guards for all I care," Mrs. Fairty snapped, her face flushed with anger.
"There's to be four in each berth, and since we'll be berthing down a ways, the girl will be stopping here, thank you." Without further ado, she picked Bridie up and thrust her onto the platform. The girl crawled into a corner opposite Patrick and shrank down. Mora, seeing how frightened the child was, reached up and touched her hand.
"It's all right," she said softly. "It's the same for us all, but you need not fear. We'll soon be getting to America, where all will be fine."
Chapter 82. Laurence in the Hold. Though Laurence was pretty sure that the stowaway search party had gone above decks, he was afraid to stand up and stretch himself. Suppose the searchers came back? As it was, he remained crouched down between two barrels, listening intently, all the while aware of the taste of blood from his bitten lip. After 10 more minutes, he cautiously raised his head and looked about. By the light of the open hatchway above, he gazed at the cargo. It seemed endless. Row upon row of crates, boxes, barrels. There was also a considerable amount of litter, sticks, staves, and blocks of wood. Moreover, the entire hold was so terribly afoul, with such a ghastly stench, the rasping and grating of wooden timbers so irritatingly incessant, that Laurence hardly knew what to cover first, his eyes, his ears, or his mouth. Growing bolder, he began to roam. At the stern of the boat, he found a room with a door partially ajar. Curious, he pulled the door open. Though he could see nothing, he smelled the distinct sweet smell of bread. It was strong enough to make his stomach growl. Feeling his way, Laurence entered the room and banged into something hard. Groping blindly, he felt what seemed to be stacks of small, light and very hard squares of wood. Was it what he'd seen before? Wood blocks? He couldn't tell. He picked one up and sniffed it. It was something bread-like. Once again, his stomach growled. Laurence put the square to his mouth and tried to bite into it. It was as hard as rock. Convinced that no matter how hard it was, he'd nonetheless found bread, Laurence took a few of the squares and continued wandering through the dark, eating or trying to as he went. Bit by bit, the bread softened until at last he was able to break off a piece. He felt something wiggle. It was a worm. Hastily, he plucked it out. Though it made him feel queasy to eat, he was so hungry he did anyway. The bread had a sour taste and gritty texture. He continued to eat, finding and throwing away two more worms before he gradually consumed an entire square. Having eased his hunger a trifle, he began to work on a second. The more he ate, the thirstier he became. Harking to the continual sound of water sloshing below his feet, he lay down and pushed his fingers between the planking. When his fingers touched wetness, he pulled back his hand, eager to suck at the moisture. The smell proved so offensive, he could not. His thirst now raged. Feeling desperate, he began to search for another source of water. Midships, he came upon two great metal tanks, very much taller than he was, as well as wider. He had no idea what they were. As he groped his way by, his hand drew across the surface of one. It was cool and wet. When he sniffed his fingers and sensed nothing bad, he licked the moisture off. The taste of water. Excited, he pressed both hands flat against one of the tanks, then hastened to lick more from them. He tried again along another part of the tank and licked the water off. He smiled, recalling his sister's cat washing herself. 20 minutes later, his thirst was slaked. Continuing to explore, Laurence came upon a narrow ladder leading up into darkness near the stern of the ship. He wondered what would happen if he climbed it, but he thought of the searchers and refrained. As he stood there, he heard a high-pitched squeaking noise. It was different from the sound the ship's timbers made, and it came from first one place, then another. Something ran over his foot. Involuntarily, Laurence screamed. The squeaking stopped abruptly. He knew then what the sound was. Rats. He decided he must find a permanent place to hide, somewhere he might sleep safe from men and rats. First, he made his way to the bow and located the crate in which Fred had stowed him aboard. For a brief moment, he thought of climbing back in, but the notion was repugnant. He wanted nothing more to do with that box, ever. He wandered back among the barrels. Though many of them were taller than he, Laurence tried now and again to lift a lid. Not one of them budged. He tried some crates, too, but with no better results. Returning to the barrels, he set about checking each one, row by row, avoiding those along the aisles. After a full hour, he found one whose lid was open a crack, hardly wide enough for his fingers. He pulled, but it would not give. Counting barrels by rows until he reached the aisle, Laurence searched out a stick to pry the lid open. Again, by counting, he found his way back to the barrel, eased the stick into the crack, and pulled down. With a sudden pop, the lid flew off. Excited by his success, Laurence hauled himself up the barrel side and fished inside with his hands. What he touched was straw. It smelled sweet and clean. Plunging his hand down into the straw, he felt some crockery, grasped it, and pulled out a teacup. One by one, he removed the cups and saucers. He took out 100 altogether and stashed them individually and in groups about the hold, behind timbers, into nooks and crannies, any place he thought would be out of sight. By the time he was done, he was able to crawl into the barrel itself, press the straw down, and sink upon a scratchy but pleasant-smelling soft cushion. He found it quite roomy, big enough to allow him to sit comfortably if he drew up his legs. Pleased with what he'd achieved, Laurence stood up and drew the barrel lid partway over the opening. It was easy then to manoeuvre the lid atop the barrel, and even as he squatted down, to pull it back as it had been. He could only hope it was not noticeably open. Sitting in total darkness, Laurence took from his pocket the last of his bread squares and began to suck on it, on the alert for worms. As he ate, his thoughts drifted, and he tried to remember, for it seemed so long ago, when it was that he had left his home. To his astonishment, it was but 3 days past. Impossible. He counted the days again and again. 3 days. Amazed, he shook his head. He thought then of his London house, where the rooms were so many. "This is my room now," he said to himself, touching the side of the barrel. He made up his mind that each day the ship sailed, he would pretend the barrel was a different London room. He would start with his own room, recalling each and every object just as it had been 3 days ago. He began by thinking about his bed in London. It was high. It was plump. It had lacy pillows. By the time Laurence thought of the pillows, he was fast asleep. Chapter 83. An Identity Revealed. The two staterooms on the Robert Peel could be found beneath the quarterdeck near the stern of the ship. The rooms had no windows, though in each a large overhead oil lamp provided sufficient light. The woodwork, of well-finished mahogany, satinwood and maple, was replete with carved scrolls and capitals, some even edged in gold. A washstand with saltwater pump, a chest of drawers, a writing desk supplied with paper and ink, a sofa and two beds, one on either side of the room, made up the furniture. Everything, including a rug, was bolted down. "I rather like it," Mr. Clemspool announced as he sat on one of the beds and kneaded the soft mattress with his fleshy fingers. "But then I deeply believe that if he pays a fair price, a gentleman should expect something decent, don't you think?"
Mr. Grout lay stretched upon his bunk, feeling miserable. His stomach was still queasy. His head was dizzy.
"Bloody small and crowded, if you ask me,"
the young man said between clenched teeth.
"I could have done much better in London at half the price, and I wouldn't be pitching and rolling neither."
"Ah, but Mr. Grout, consider. Here you are, free from the restraints of your past. Far better than sitting in jail,"
Mr. Clemspool suggested.
"Begging your pardon," Mr. Grout said peevishly. "I wasn't going to no jail."
"Now, sir, let us not forget that money."
He looked slyly at his friend.
"Where would you be, sir, without it?"
The portly man smiled sweetly and looked about with a deadpan air.
"I must confess," he said, hastening to change the subject, "I do wish I'd had the time to gather my personal belongings."
"No one said you had to come," Mr. Grout replied,
still smarting from his companion's remark about jail.
"You might have gone back to London and done what you do. It would have saved me a pretty penny."
"Me go back? Not I," Mr. Clemspool returned. "That investigator, Mr. Pickler, made it perfectly clear that he was going to bring an action against me."
"Fearful, are you?"
"To be frank," Mr. Clemspool admitted, "it was not him I feared. It was Mr. Pickler's employer."
"Which is why you're heading for America."
Mr. Clemspool pondered the remark. Then, as much to himself as to Mr. Grout, he said,
"But to make my point precisely, perhaps I can strike back."
Mr. Grout raised himself on an elbow.
"What's that supposed to mean?"
"Is it not worth considering?"
Mr. Clemspool asked, examining the idea even as he proposed it.
"How Mr. Pickler's venerated employer would react to the knowledge that his rude cur of an elder son endeavoured to send his second son out of England permanently."
Mr. Grout shook his head.
"What was the boy's name?"
Mr. Clemspool considered. Then he said,
"No harm in your knowing now. It was Sir Laurence Kirkle."
Mr. Grout sat bolt upright.
"Kirkle?"
he cried.
"Of the government?"
"The same,"
returned Mr. Clemspool smugly.
"You're mad to touch that kind."
Mr. Clemspool plucked the air as if it contained an invisible harp.
"He may rot at the bottom of a ditch for all I care."
"Here, do you think he's dead?"
"I sincerely hope so,"
Mr. Clemspool said.
"The dead can come back at you," Mr. Grout warned.
"Nonsense. Anyway, I'm engaged upon a greater purpose. My new life. I suppose I could inform the boy's father, or..."
He stopped short, his mouth open, his fingers extended.
"Or what?"
Mr. Grout asked. The talk of death and ghosts had unnerved him. Mr. Clemspool snatched at the air as if it held the very answer he was looking for.
"Yes. Perhaps it would be better if I communicated with the older brother, Sir Albert Kirkle."
"Either one who hired you?"
"He was indeed. Yes. I shall write Sir Albert and say I have his brother with me."
"But you don't."
"Of course not, you fool. He's in Liverpool somewhere, thank goodness. But I will tell Sir Albert that I shall inform his father about his scheme, engaging me to dispose of Sir Lawrence, unless he sends me a sum of money sufficiently large to cover my losses."
"Blackmail,"
said Mr. Grout with a nod of his head.
"Sir," Mr. Clemspool returned with a withering glance, "I do not engage in illegalities like some, I might mention. No, I am merely desirous of finding some means of defraying losses that have been brought down about my innocent head. It will be no more than what he owes me. One lump of money, or a regular allowance, like?"
The question prompted a wide smile.
"Mr. Grout, I do sometimes believe you can actually think. Indeed, it is always better to have a steady income. Such befits a gentleman."
"Gentlemen, who are you talking about now?"
"Me."
Mr. Grout pushed himself up from his bed and snatched up his hat.
I need to look about, he announced,
and somewhat unsteady, went out of the room. Mr. Clemspool was quick to follow. Chapter 84. Mr. Clemspool about his business. Mr. Grout groped his way up to the quarterdeck to a room maintained for first-class gentlemen passengers. A small space, it contained little more than a U-shaped sofa built into the walls, where passengers could smoke the cigars set out for them in a canister. Mr. Grout arrived with Mr. Clemspool at his heels.
Now, see here, Clemspool,
Mr. Grout said, his back braced against the wall and his one good eye fixed upon his companion.
You do what you want in your business, but I want nothing to do with it any more. Messing around with swells like the Kirkles ain't smart. They've got ways to punch back that's hot and heavy.
Ah, Mr. Grout, said Mr. Clemspool, sitting and selecting a cigar.
You are a callow youth, much too timid. Me? Timid? Not by your life. It's just that I knows about live folks as well as dead ones, and pays heed to both kinds.
Mr. Clemspool waved his unlit cigar grandly.
You need not worry, sir. I have no intention of being dependent on you.
Don't you?
You, sir, are, to make my point precisely, beneath me.
Flushing with anger, Mr. Grout pushed himself away from the wall.
Just don't forget.
At that instant, the door was flung open and another man entered. His top hat, greatcoat and silk muffler proclaimed him a gentleman. Moreover, though he was not tall, his considerable bulk and a mane of flowing graying hair helped give him a look of authority. His face was square, with a firm chin and smooth waxen cheeks, rather like the sculptured head of an ancient Roman. Half-smile, there was none. As for his eyes, they were small, grey, and set together closely, giving him a hard, disdainful expression. The newcomer nodded briskly to Mr. Clemspool and Mr. Grout as he rubbed his hands vigorously to create some warmth.
I fear I shall be chilled until home comes into view, he announced in an American accent. The sea air cuts to my bones.
I'm sorry to hear it, sir, Mr. Clemspool allowed.
I hate these voyages,
the man informed his listeners, as if they needed to know his mind.
As you must. But when you have as many responsibilities as I do, you're in demand. A man's business is his own. I trust my mother, sir, but no one else's. No doubt you've come to the same conclusions.
I certainly have,
Mr. Clemspool hastened to say as he rose and offered his hand to the stranger.
Mr. Matthew Clemspool of London, a pleasure to make your acquaintance, sir.
Ambrose Shagwell,
the man announced as he shook the proffered hand so hard it was all Mr. Clemspool could do to keep from crying out.
You must be the other first-class passengers. My home is in Lowell, fairest city in the great Commonwealth of Massachusetts, the United States of America, engaged in the manufacture of cotton textiles. And you, sir?
Not in any particular business, sir, replied Mr. Clemspool, waving his hand airily. I am sailing to America to see what might engage me. That's to say, I have large funds at my disposal.
Mr. Grout snorted at the man's boldness. The American, however, cast a newly appreciative eye upon Mr. Clemspool.
You are an investor, then?
I am, sir, replied Mr. Clemspool with a nod that seemed to imply much.
With large funds, you say?
Mr. Clemspool plucked at the air.
Do you consider 50,000 a lot?
Not only did Mr. Shagwell extend his hand to Mr. Clemspool a second time, his grip was quite tender.
You are more than welcome to America, sir, he said. We have room for men of enterprise. Just understand that our ways and means are advanced and distinct from yours. Seek to impose old world ways upon us, and we shall have trouble. America, first and always,
Mr. Shagwell concluded, pointing to one of his eyes, then his nose, and with the same hand shaping his thumb and first finger into a circle. Finally, he nodded portentously, as if these signs held some significant meaning. Mr. Clemspool, though puzzled, chose to ignore them.
"I am not here to dispute you, sir," he returned with an engaging smile.
"Well, then," Mr. Shagwell enthused, "our friendship shall flourish. But you, young man," he said to Mr. Grout, "I don't have the pleasure of your acquaintance."
"Toby Grout," a baleful Mr. Grout replied.
"Also in business?"
"Nothing in particular."
"I hope, Mr. Grout, that you're not one of these lazy, ill-educated fellows who come to my country merely to gawk. We do not appreciate laziness there. Hard, honest work has made us great. Hard, honest work will make us greater."
"Excellent philosophy," Mr. Clemenceau applauded. "Mr. Grout will be indebted to you for your advice."
"Happy to be helpful," Mr. Shagwell said. "But I was taking my walk about the deck. I intend to do so 3 times a day, regardless of the weather. Gentlemen, since we 3 constitute the first-class passengers, I trust I shall see you at the captain's table. Good day."
So saying, he left the room. The moment the door shut, Mr. Clemenceau laughed.
"I don't see what's funny," Mr. Grout complained. "Saying you have 50,000. You have nothing."
"Give me a man who has nothing but answers," Mr. Clemenceau observed, "and I shall show you a man who has no questions. I enjoy doing business with a man like that."
"Where are you going?"
"I'm going to find that Mr. Drabble and fix up them reading lessons as he promised."
"Do so, Mr. Grout. You heard what that Shagwell fellow said. In America, laziness is not appreciated."
For his part, Ambrose Shagwell, striding about the quarterdeck, speculated if this man Clemenceau were not the answer to his great problem, his pressing need for money. He rather thought he was. Chapter 85. Mr. Drabble at the Bowsprit. At the bowsprit of the Robert Peel, a thin spray of sea blew upon Mr. Drabble's forehead like a cooling hand. This was a considerable blessing, since the actor's whole mind still burned with Maura O'Connell's rejection of his proposal. To add insult to his sense of injury, she was now bestowing much attention upon Bridie, the girl who had been foisted on them. The actor, feeling jealous, had left the steerage to go up on deck. The despondent man entertained the idea of throwing himself into the waves and thus ending his misery. Though the gesture suited his mood, he was not so wretched as to believe that such an act would inspire love in Maura. Even if it did, how could he rejoice in it at the bottom of the sea? Instead, Mr. Drabble thought about his life. He was willing to acknowledge that he'd been a failure in England. In fact, the more he thought about it, the more certain he was that Maura had refused him for exactly that reason. Or was it because that runner Toggs had knocked him down so easily at Mrs. Sunderby's? Oh, why hadn't he put up more of a fight? Because, he told himself, he was a coward. Perhaps, the actor mused, he should have remained in Liverpool. There at least he'd earned a few pennies. It was a kind of living. What could he possibly do in America? A line from Hamlet crept into his head. When sorrows come, they come not single spies, but in battalions. The words soothed him. Emboldened, he recited other lines from Shakespeare. The more he spoke, the better he felt. Soon he was emoting in his most flamboyant manner, extending his hands and arms, presenting his profile to the wind, until, when he was finished, he felt obliged to take a deep bow. To his surprise, he heard applause. He turned. There was Mr. Grout.
"Bravo!" the man cried. "You're in finer voice as ever."
"I'm happy to see you, sir," Mr. Drabble returned, though he was, in fact, not overjoyed to have company. There was something comforting in reciting tragic lines to an uncaring wind.
"Practicing for your American performing?" Mr. Grout asked.
The actor smiled grimly, but was unable to resist someone's interest in him.
"Mr. Grout, sir, I confess I don't know exactly what I shall do in America."
"Course, sir, know what I'll do myself," agreed Mr. Grout. "Right now I'm feeling sick with the way the ship heaves. It's all I can think of."
"Surely your friend can provide some relief?" Mr. Grout snorted.
My friend, if you want to call him that, ain't concerned with much but himself. What I need is to strike out on me own.
Going alone, Mr. Drabble agreed, is the fate of mankind.
I still want you to be teaching me some reading. It might help.
Mr. Grout, Mr. Drabble exclaimed with weariness, you must not place me too high in your esteem. I am nothing, no more than the lowest of the low.
He bowed to demonstrate the fact.
To tell the truth, Mr. Grout said, I'm glad to hear it.
Why is that? Asked Mr. Drabble, who, though eager for sympathy, was grieved to be taken as deserving of his own doleful estimation.
Between you and me, Mr. Drabble, I'm not so high as you might think. Some day I might tell you all I've got to answer for. Avoid the dead and take what you can of the living. Ask me why. So if you thinks yourself low, why, I'm low too. Which is reason enough we could be comrades.
Mr. Drabble extended his hand warmly. Nothing would give me more pleasure, sir.
Just don't forget I still want these reading lessons. I can pay for them too, and I'd rather give the money to you than some other people I know.
Chapter 86. Mr. Clemsball writes a letter. Matthew Clemsball stood before his stateroom desk and removed a sheet of paper from the pile in the drawer. How much, he asked himself, should he reveal to Sir Albert about what had happened to his brother? After some deliberation, he decided indeed to claim that he had Sir Lawrence with him. So what if it were a lie? Sir Albert expected the boy to be on his way to America. That had been the assignment from the start, after all. After dipping his pen in the blue ink and trying to accommodate his hand to the rolling of the ship, Mr. Clemsball wrote.
My dear Sir Albert, I send you greetings from the sea. I wish to inform you that I have the property about which you are concerned safely with me. Indeed, I decide I could best serve your interests if I myself carried it to America and disposed of it there, as you so much desired. Now, sir, since I am going to such considerable lengths to do your bidding, I must ask you for some payment as soon as possible. I require a fee of £1,000. Then, in addition, I ask you to pay me the sum of £100 monthly until such time as I alter the arrangement. I entreat you to do this quickly, for the post across the Atlantic is slow, and I have incurred considerable expense on your behalf. In return, you have my word as a gentleman that no information regarding your desires shall ever reach the esteemed ears of your Lord Father. But of course, sir, if you do not see fit to pay your bills promptly, I will be forced to inform your father directly about what you paid me to do. I am sure you can appreciate the complications that might result.
Mr. Clemsball read and reread what he had written, making only a few minor adjustments. After due consideration, he added,
As to my address in America, I have yet to determine upon a permanent abode, or even whether I will remain in the country. But you should write to me in the care of Mr. Ambrose Shagwell in the city of Lowell, Massachusetts, USA. I am sure word will reach me. Mr. Shagwell is a highly esteemed gentleman and a good friend, a man I trust and, sir, a confidant in all my affairs. Trusting you are, sir, continuing in good health, I remain faithfully yours, Matthew Clemsball, Esquire.
The letter written, Mr. Clemsball stepped out of the stateroom into the long galleyway. On the other side of the galleyway was the dining room, where the three first-class passengers would eat their meals with the captain, first mate, and the ship's doctor. At the forward end of the galley was a large door providing access to the main deck. At the stern end was the captain's quarters. The galley itself was windowless, lit only by a single oil lamp far forward. Mr. Clemsball turned toward the captain's cabin. When he heard voices from inside, he knocked.
Enter!
A voice commanded. Mr. Clemsball opened the door. Captain Rickles and his first mate, Mr. Murdoch, were conferring.
Yes, Mr. Clemswell, the captain said, looking up. What can I do for you?
I don't wish to trouble you, sir, but I understand that from time to time as we sail, we meet with other ships.
We do, sir, the captain replied. And when we meet them, we heave to and share information.
Do they ever carry letters?
Always and happily.
Then, Mr. Clemspool said, holding up his letter to Sir Albert, might I request that this be sent to England when the first opportunity presents itself? It concerns important financial matters.
The captain took the letter and looked at the name and address. Mr. Clemspool noted that he was impressed. I can assure you, sir, you may count upon me. The shipping lanes are full this time of year. We shall certainly bespeak someone. Your letter will be passed on.
I am much obliged, Mr. Clemspool said, and bowed his way out, shutting the door behind him. Once beyond the door, however, he lingered and listened.
As I was saying, Captain,
it was the first mate speaking,
that stowaway is about somewhere, and I'll ferret him out, even if it's in Boston Bay.
Mr. Clemspool, having not the slightest interest in the topic of stowaways, turned back to his own stateroom, confident of his future. Chapter 87. 7:35 p.m. Lowell, Massachusetts. Crowds of workers, women mostly, but men and children too, poured out through the gates of the Shagwell Cotton Mill Company, the night air frosting their breaths. With their way lit by glowing curbside gas lamps and handheld flares, they headed for boarding houses, rooms, or shanties, whatever it was they called their homes in this gloomy town of Lowell, Massachusetts. Amid the throng walked two men. The older was Gregory O'Connell, father to Maura and Patrick, whom they called Dar. Though barely 50 years of age, Mr. O'Connell had the sad and grizzled look of a tired, broken man. A small slip of a fellow, he had stooped shoulders and a round, creased face with dark hollows beneath his eyes. His boots and jacket were old and patched. The muffler about his neck was torn. His companion, Nathaniel Brewster, had never seen him laugh. A tall, gangly, broad-shouldered 17-year-old, Nathaniel had an awkward, often clumsy walk, unruly brown hair, lively hazel eyes, and a quick smile. Born and raised on a farm in Maine, he was the youngest son of a large family. Having no expectations of an inheritance, and wanting neither a sailor's life nor a fisherman's, he decided he'd go to the new state of California in search of gold. With little more than his poor parents' blessing, he had set off by way of Boston in hopes of getting a ship. On the docks, however, he discovered he would have to raise a fair amount of money before he could sail, for the voyage around Cape Horn was costly and of several months' duration. Nathaniel promptly sought employment. It was in Boston, in cheap lodgings, that he met Gregory O'Connell. Mr. O'Connell, being much bewildered and lonely in the New World, welcomed the bold but caring kindness of one who knew American custom. As for Nathaniel, he felt better in the company of a dour elder. So it was that the two men had begun their winter-spring friendship 9 months before. Together, they struggled to establish themselves by sharing bed and board. For the past few months, they'd worked steadily in the mills of Lowell, 30 miles to the northwest of Boston. That evening, as the two men negotiated the pits and holes in icy Adams Street, neither spoke. Toiling from 5:30 in the morning till 7:30 at night had quite exhausted them. Suddenly, though still some distance from their rented room, Mr. O'Connell stopped. No, he announced, as if he had come to a decision after much debate.
I'll never get used to it.
What's that? Nathaniel asked. Though his thoughts were on dinner, he paused in deference to the elder man.
That's the dreadful noise and cotton dust in the mill, Mr. O'Connell said. A man can hardly breathe, I think. Or, he added ruefully, even live.
Mr. O'Connell, Nathaniel said with his good-natured laugh, seems to me you're forgetting we're being paid for our work.
and faith, Mr. O'Connell replied. I was raised on the land. Worked my bit, may the Holy Mother bless it. An old-fashioned life, you're forever saying, Mr. Brewster. But here, it's 800 machines banging and crashing 14 hours a day. Doesn't the floor itself tremble? He lifted a hand, only to drop it when unable to find words to express himself. You've said it all before, Mr. O'Connell, Nathaniel reminded him, eager to move on. The Irishman held his ground and shook his head. By all the blessed saints, Nathaniel, I don't suspect you'll be hearing me say it for very much longer. You've said that too, so often, Nathaniel replied. I reckon you'll be saying it 50 years from now. You don't understand, Mr. O'Connell insisted. I'm a doomed man. This woeful prediction brought another laugh from Nathaniel. Mr. O'Connell, he said, keep in mind that things are different here in America.
They are.
And the biggest difference, the young man reminded his elder, is that you're employed.
I'll not deny it.
For hard cash.
$4 a week.
And you eat.
I do.
While in that island of yours, so you've told me, there was no work, cash or food.
There are those, Mr. Brewster, who have no love of the Irish.
Now, Mr. O'Connell, you have many a friend at the mill. Mr. O'Connell looked up at Nathaniel.
Faith, lad, don't you miss your family?
Of course I do, the young man returned. But before I left, my father took me aside. Nathaniel, says he, don't waste your time missing us. We'll be here forever, alive or dead.
A kind man you have for a father, Mr. O'Connell said.
He is, Nathaniel agreed with a touch of impatience. But we should get on, Mr. O'Connell. I can smell snow in the wind, and I'm roaring hungry. Mr. O'Connell, however, would not move.
By the living Jesus, he cried, I wish I'd never left home.
Mr. O'Connell, Nathaniel said, how many times have we agreed we did the right thing by leaving our homes? Besides, your wife and children will be with you soon.
God willing.
Look how quick you raised the cash for their passage.
But hundreds die in those coffin ships, the Irishman said.
Mr. O'Connell, you're living proof that not everyone dies. You'll be reunited soon.
No more faithful wife than Annie O'Connell,
Mr. O'Connell was quick to acknowledge. The thought was sufficiently soothing that he began to walk again. And there's your lovely daughter, Maura, Nathaniel added with care. Tall and strong, with thick brown hair and blue eyes. There, you see, you've told me so much about her. I sometimes think I'm already in love with the girl.
Mr. O'Connell stopped abruptly. Nathaniel, alarmed, asked, did I speak too free?
Lad,
Mr. O'Connell said with considerable difficulty. The truth is, I never felt so ill as I do now. Weren't the moments today when I was certain the machines were about to snap my soul from my heart? I could hardly keep up. I was that dizzy with confusion. Terrible pains, too, he added, touching his heart.
Aye, I'm a beaten man, he concluded sadly.
Mr. O'Connell, Nathaniel said lightly, you've been dying since I met you.
He moved on. Mr. O'Connell did not. His heart seemed to contract in pain. His breathing grew difficult.
Mr. Brewster! He cried out in alarm.
The young man stopped and looked back.
If something happens to me, he managed to say, something before my family comes, it's your vow that you'll always be their friend. It's that I'm waiting to hear.
Nathaniel ambled back.
Of course I'll be their friend, he replied. And if a decent Catholic is willing to shake the hand of an equally decent Protestant, you can have my hand on it.
A trembling Mr. O'Connell held out his hand. Nathaniel grasped it gladly. Then, having recovered his breath and the pain subsiding, Mr. O'Connell went on with his friend. But as whirlpools of old snow spun like tops all about them, Gregory O'Connell prayed under his breath.
Holy Mother, he whispered, just let me live till my family comes.
Chapter 88. A Meeting in Lowell. That evening, the snow Nathaniel had predicted for Lowell arrived. It was born on the edge of a sharp, sleet-edged wind that sliced through the wide expanse of Merrimack Street, the city's principal thoroughfare. Windows rattled, doors banged, store signs whipped like the wings of frightened birds. The few people and horses out and about were forced to bow their heads in submission as they struggled to find warmer, kindlier refuges. Though it was an evening designed to keep citizens at home, a meeting was being held in the back room of the Spindle City Hotel and Oyster Bar on the main street. It was a hotel that catered to the itinerant salesman, the mechanic, the travelling businessman. Public gatherings were often held there. This meeting, however, was not a public one. Indeed, a ragged boy had been posted next to the entryway with clear instructions to give an alarm if anyone else tried to enter. By the boy's side was a box upon which was written, "Shine, 2 cents." There were four people gathered. Of the three men and one woman seated at the square table in one corner of the room, three wore hats and coats. Whether they did so because the room was cold or because they wanted to be ready to flee at a moment's notice was not clear. But now and again, as the wind blew by with its low, dirge-like sound, they lifted their heads, listened intently, and were inwardly pleased. The storm would be the most effective guardian of their meeting. Who, upon such a night, when hearths at home were heated, would desire to engage in a discussion about the menace of immigrants? The four shared one small lighted candle. It stood on the table close enough to illuminate the one bareheaded person in the room. His name was Jeremiah Jenkins. The shaggy white hair and full fringe of white whiskers about Mr. Jenkins' face suggested he had reached advanced years. Not so. His skin was smooth, and his eyes beneath bushy dark eyebrows were as bright as candle flames. He appeared to have a fire within, the strength of which helped him command the rapt attention of his small audience.
"And what I'm telling you, friends," Jeremiah Jenkins was saying in a voice that oozed confidentiality, "is however refined it is to talk about these problems, what truly counts in this world is the action you take. Friends," he ventured, looking into each of his listeners' faces, "may I suggest the time for action is at hand?"
"Hear, hear,"
came a murmured reply from one of the men, a stooped, shrunken fellow who had something of a rat's appearance.
"Do I have to remind you people," Mr. Jenkins continued, "of the decrease in wages now offered working men and women, the increase in crime, filth and illness in this once great city of Lowell?"
"Not by me, you don't,"
responded another of the men warmly, a beefy round man, middle-aged, who wore his hat perched high on his head.
"I'm pleased you agree," said Mr. Jenkins, reaching across the table to shake the man's hand with something that suggested gratitude.
He then swiveled about in his chair.
"You there,"
he called across the room to the boy sitting by the door. The boy, who had been daydreaming, started up.
"Yes, mister."
"Do you have a name?"
Mr. Jenkins gave a wink to his table mates.
"Jeb Grafton."
The boy had a raw red face that seemed to have been recently peeled to expose a perpetual pout. His trousers were ragged, his thin jacket frayed and split at the elbows. The cloth cap he wore was pulled so low that he seemed to look upon the world as if from under a ledge.
"Come over here, boy,"
Mr. Jenkins said kindly. The boy shuffled over and stood sheepishly by the man.
"Do you go to school, Jeb Grafton?"
Jeb gave a contemptuous grunt.
"I suppose I did, for a while. I'm 13 now."
"And how many in your school were foreigners?"
Jeb screwed up his face.
"Pretty much half."
"Is that why you left?"
The boy shrugged.
"They were too stupid for me."
"There, you see,"
Mr. Jenkins said with a slap of his hand on the table, so loud and sudden it made his listeners jump.
"That's what it's come to. The foreigners have even taken over the schools from our children. Now, friends," he continued in a somewhat modulated voice, "you know very well who the worst of these foreigners are. the Irish.
The word Irish was spoken slowly in two equally stressed syllables, the second slipping out with a hiss.
Even as I speak, they are crowding onto our shores by the thousands, by the tens of thousands, starving beggars, each and every one of them, all expecting to live on handouts from the government, your government. Are they grateful? Not a bit. To whom do these Irish give their allegiance? To the Roman Church? That's who. To priests, nuns, bishops, and popes. Friends, I'm here tonight to warn you that the Republic is under attack by these people. I say we must fight back.
And what are we supposed to do about it? The woman who asked the question was named Betsy Howard. She was young, with a broad, open face and dark hair. They take low wages, and they don't mind how fast the machines go, she added.
Where do you work? Mr. Jenkins asked.
Shagwell Cotton Mill.
The smile on Mr. Jenkins' face withered. He leaned forward.
Are they taking on Irish there, too? He asked.
Quite a few. Mr. Jenkins sat back in his chair, visibly shaken. For a moment he seemed lost in thought. His eyes flashed, his fingers fidgeted.
Then, as quickly as the emotion had come, it subsided. He smiled wryly.
What are we to do? He said. I'll tell you what I do. There's an inn in Boston, the Liberty Tree Inn, right on the docks. The immigrants often head there directly from the ships. I wait for them there, and when I see them, you can always recognize them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.